I'm very excited to introduce Rain Thomas. She's a breast cancer survivor, but she's a musician, an actor, an author, an inspirational humorist, a fantastic dresser, an amazing blues singer who I hope is going to come and entertain us in Seattle soon. She's worked in theater, movies, commercials, voiceovers, and she's walked in New York Fashion Week. Her goal in life is to make a difference globally through laughter and prunes. Please join me in welcoming Rain.
It's Saturday night, about time to go. Got my white leather jacket and a neon soap. Once I turn on the radio, I'm ready to roll. Ready to roll. Feel like a heart to kill.
Good morning. Good morning. There we go. Thank you, YSC. This is such an honor. You guys, thank you so much. Before I get started, you'll see on your table that there are prunes. And some people have stopped me and said, prunes. Yes, I am the owner of Prunes Are Sexy. Prunes, yes. Prunes are my favorite fruit. They have been since I was a little girl because I wasn't allowed to eat candy. And of course, when you tell people prunes are sexy, they look at you like you just said you broke in the Pope's house and stole his wallet. They're small, they're beautiful, and people always say, oh, but look at them. You guys, you know what? I just want you to know, I think the world would be a better place if we didn't judge so much from the outside, because the beauty and the goodness of things are on the inside. So I have been volunteering and fundraising for breast cancer and cancer since 1976. Yes, I started when I was one. And not because it was in my family. I had an uncle in the hospital, totally unrelated. He had a blood clot or something. And, you know, this is the day when people used to go and sit all day. And the head nurse said to my mom, you know, she looks bored. Why don't you let her do the runs with me? And she had the oncology unit. So I used to go with her, and you know, people would say, little girl, will you read to me? Little girl, will you play chess with me? Little girl, will you sing me a song? And I understood, you know, because the nurse told me, these people were suffering, you know, some of them weren't gonna go home, and I thought, if all they want is someone to talk to or play a game or read a story, how come everyone isn't doing that? So that's where I started my breast cancer and cancer journey. So now I'm going to tell you a little bit about being present. I've always been chastised growing up because I like to daydream. I'm an artist. Present, present, present. The reason things don't happen for you is because you aren't present. You're never present. So 20, 25 years ago, I started going to all these weekend things where they teach you to be present. And some of you are groaning. You know what that sounds like, right? You get there and they say, today you're going to learn to be present. Present, present, present. That's what you're gonna do, present. And I'd go home and I'm like, okay, I still don't feel present. I daydream and I'd feel guilty. Well, about 20 years ago, I went to one that was like a 3-day seminar. And I gotta tell you, I was so stressed when I left there because it was like Pavlov's dog. The guy would say to people, the reason your life is crappy is because you weren't present. The reason that you aren't a good person is because you're not present. And I thought, oh my goodness, this guy says, well, you know, I didn't make some of my choices. Yes, you did. Subconsciously, you weren't present, and that's why those things happened to you. And I was so stressed. I'm like, oh my goodness. So I got home, and I thought, you know, there's got to be a better way to give that information to people. And so I started thinking, you know, we live in a society that doesn't want you to be present anyway. You know, if you're present, you can't keep thinking about tomorrow. We live in a tomorrow society. Don't believe me? Next time you hear a gym membership commercial, I want you to listen to it. They will say, come in today, sign up, and in 30 days, you will be on your way to your best body ever. 30 days on my way? First of all, don't insult me, because how do you know this isn't my best body ever? Just needs a little tweaking tune-up, you know? And why 30 days? If I sign up today and I get in there and I work out, shouldn't I feel good today? Shouldn't this be my start today? No, you got to tell me 30 days because the body I have now is not good enough. Because that's the subliminal message behind it. Think about some of the ads for sleeping pills. Start taking this pill in 7 to 14 days, you'll get the best sleep you ever had. Oh no, I want to sleep tonight. Why can't I go to that gym that I just signed up, have an awesome workout, come home, eat something wonderful, and then go to bed and have a good night's rest? What's wrong with that? You know? So I started thinking more, how could I get this message across of being present? Then it dawned on me, I have some best friends. I love them, all of them. And I was like, if I were at a restaurant, my best friend, and she or he pulled out their phone and just started, you know, doing whatever, and we hadn't seen each other in a while, how would it go over if I started screaming at them? You're not present. We're supposed to be here together. You aren't present. How dare you sit here with me and not be present? I think the evening would probably be over. So then I thought, what if I reached across the table, put my hand on my friend's hand, and said, hey, you know, we haven't seen each other for a while. Thought we could catch up. Look at your phone later. Let's spend this time right now. And then the light bulb came on. So I started going around telling people, because they speak at a lot of survivor things and a lot of different things, and telling people about right now. Because right now is really all you have. You don't have tomorrow. You know, people are always telling you you're not good enough. The things you own aren't good enough. You know, you go buy a $600 phone, you walk out the store, you get a commercial when you get home says, your phone is old. Not good enough. You know, you buy a 2,000 square foot house, that's not good enough because the next door, they got a 4,000 square foot house. Not good enough. Never tall enough, not pretty enough, smart enough, not enough makeup, not enough anything. But right now, you are good enough. So let me go forward. Trust me, this is all coming together. The prunes, the gym, it's all happening. My cancer journey. I was staying with a couple of friends who I had only known 2 months, their brother and sister. I'd met the brother at a retreat in California. I live in Vegas. And he said, I live in Arizona and love for you to come stay with us. Okay, you know, tell me twice. And I met his sister who's wonderful. And we were on our way to, do you need me? Oh, thank you. We were on our way to an art party. And I had had a biopsy April 28th, 2011. I'm like, I take care of myself. I'm fine. I don't worry about it. I've had them since, you know, forever. So we're on our way out the door. The phone rings. I go back and get it. It's my doctor. She calls me Rainey. She says, Rainey, it's breast cancer. I love Dr. O'Neill. She's right to the point, just the way I am. She says, you know what? We're going to get through this. Don't you worry. Monday, you be in my office at 7 o'clock. Got it? Okay. Click. Yeah, she said, she hung up. So I sat there and I thought, wow, she couldn't have been calling me because I didn't smoke, I didn't drink, I didn't use drugs, I took care of my body, I didn't eat fast food, I didn't eat sugar, it doesn't run in my family. You guys know how it goes, right? Are you still with me?
Yes.
So I called my husband, called my friends, left messages, called me back. And I went in, Doc and Cherie, you know, they were at the door, they're like, everything's good, right? I said, yeah, my doctor said I had breast cancer, let's go. And they were like, okay. I said, yeah, let's go, because you know what I've been telling all of my survivor sisters and brothers and people, you only have right now. And right now, I'm going to that party. There are artists there. I don't know who I'm going to meet that might change my life or I change theirs. So we go to the party, and you know, while I'm at the party, it's so fun. It's in this house on a cliff, and it's all this exciting stuff. And you know how your mind wants to drift? I said, oh, no, you're not drifting. Right now, I'm enjoying this. And I went and I got a caricature done like this, which I have hanging on my wall at home. And I ate all the horse ovaries I could eat. You know what horse ovaries are? Hors d'oeuvres. Ate all I could eat, came back that evening. You know, we chat for a while and we went to bed. get up Saturday, and I look in the mirror, and I see these going past the mirror, and I'm like, what did I ever do to you guys? And then I said, no, right now, I'm in someone's home that I don't even really know that's taking care of me. They won't take any money. Doc is retired. He'd sit up all day, come up with recipes, and create a whole theme of dinner every night. This is a blessing. So, Cherie says, let's go shopping. I like it. I'm going shopping with Cherie. That's what we did, shopping and eating. And we met people. People who were wonderful. And I told everybody, yeah, I'm here because I have breast cancer. You know, I live in Phoenix. I didn't even know anybody. And people say, really? Oh, I said, no, let's go to lunch. By the way, I gained 11 pounds by the time it was all over. Just saying. So then Sunday comes, Cherie had to go to work, and it was just me and Doc, beautiful day in, you know, Scottsdale, and your mind starts running again. Oh my God, I'm gonna go tomorrow, and what if no. Right now, I need to just relax. So I'm pacing like a caged animal, you know? And Doc says, why don't you go sit by the pool and have a glass of wine? And I'm thinking, is he crazy? Did he not just hear that I have breast cancer and he wants me to sit by the pool and relax? What kind of nut could he be, right? And I'm just gonna cross in front of you, sweetie. And I stopped my mind. I said, you know what? He's right. I'm going to take his advice. I'm going to go sit by the pool, and I'm going to have a glass of wine. And by glass, I just want you to be clear, I'm talking about the one the wine came in. Just saying. So, you know. So, you know, Sunday went by, and Sunday evening, it was time to go to bed, and I thought, tomorrow I'm gonna get up and I'm gonna tackle this thing. And I was in my doctor's office at 7 o'clock, and Dr. O'Neill, she's a powerhouse. She was nose to nose. She says, this is the laundry list of stuff you have to do. You gotta get this. I'm thinking, I don't even know where I'm going here. I got my navigation thing on, because I don't live there. And I said, when can I go to surgery? She said, when you finish all this stuff. So numbly, on Monday and Tuesday, I did all the laundry stuff. I called her Tuesday evening, and I said, when can I go to surgery? I finish it. She said, my next appointment is tomorrow at 9 a.m. I was there. And you know how it goes from there, you know, there's all these things. And in that, I met my radiology doctor, who's also a breast surgeon, Dr. Robert Kusky, who invented whole breast radiation. And I thought, God is really looking out for me. So when I got to his office, and I'm sure everybody knows how overwhelming it can be when there's interns in there, and there's nurses and assistants, and somebody's drawing blood, and they're showing you stuff. And Dr. Kusky walks in, and you know, I'm Dr. Robert Kusky, and you are Rainey Thomas. I'm thinking, how does everybody keep calling me Rainey Thomas? And I said, Rain Thomas. He says, okay. And he says, you know, all these people are in there, 30 people in there. Or maybe they just doubled because I was feeling like I was gonna faint. And you know, he's feeling this and he's feeling that, and he takes my hands and he turns this hand over and he starts looking at it, and he turns and I snatch it back. I said, Dr. Kusky, I can't marry you, honey. I'm already married. And he looks at me, everybody in there deadpan looks at me. And then he starts going through his notes. And then he looks at me, he said, weren't you just diagnosed with breast cancer? I said, why, yes, I was. He said, and you're making jokes? And I said, Dr. Kusky, if I make jokes right now or not, is that gonna change my diagnosis? And he walked out. And came back 10 minutes later. So it goes on and on and on. But what I really wanna get to is to tell you the whole theme of good enough, plenty, how we're beautiful. I don't know how many of you have been in love with anything? A cat, a dog, a pigeon, a person, anybody? Okay, so I wanna tell you what I've learned about cancer, life, and love. If you've ever loved, you understand love is not a thing. It's not one big thing. It's pieces of things. If you have a spouse, you know that sometimes you can get on each other's nerves. You know, there's good days, there are not so good days. Fun days, not so fun days. You know, there's stress, not so much. laughter, tears. It's made up of all these different things, kind of like life and cancer. And to me, to be able to keep loving, if you can push all the unfun stuff down and have the other stuff rise, when you think of the great days and the great times and the laughter, those are the things that will carry you through the rest of the day. And when I talked about right now with my best friend, I want you to know you should never ever say anything to yourself that you wouldn't say to your best friend. Did you hear me? Should never say anything to yourself that you wouldn't say to your best friend. And that's what love is to me, is taking care of yourself. You know, I've talked to some of you here and you're like, oh, you know, I think when people look at me, they see this. Or if I walked up, I said, oh girl, I love your dress. Oh, this old thing. No, you're good enough. I'm here today, I'm honored to be here today to tell you, I had a lot of issues, trust me. You know, when you dress like this and you wear these kind of glasses, people do talk about you, you know? They make fun of you, and that's okay. I'm good with that. But I want you to know you're good enough. You're beautiful enough. You're strong enough. And cancer, like anything else in life, should not define who you are as a person. Just like falling down, breaking an ankle should not define you as a person. You know, trust me, I know the challenges. It's tough. Like I said, I've seen it from 1976 on. It's tough stuff. But if you can find the beauty, like all of you here today, together, because I want you to know, in my entire 100,000 years of living, trust me, this is just a young body I'm in. I want you to know the one cancer that's the worst cancer in the world is the cancer of your mind. If you allow your thoughts to get in there and tell you you're not good enough, you're not strong enough, you're not beautiful enough, you're not tall enough, you know, you take away the blessing not only from you, but from those around you. Because you know what? Everybody in here matters, and you may matter to someone that you don't even know. They look across the room and say, wow, she's so beautiful. I wish I could hold my head like that. So please don't ever think that you don't matter, because you are a blessing to someone. If you look around this room, you see you all are a blessing to each other, or you wouldn't be here. Am I right? So there's a need there to hold your head up and to feel good, because it doesn't matter what you look like. Remember, the prune's not embarrassed to be sexy on the outside and good and wonderful on the inside. Small things make up the beauty of life. Now, when you leave here today, you won't remember everything and everybody. You might remember the last workshop from what I heard, you know. You might remember that. But if you don't remember anything else that I said, I want you to remember just small things that make up who you are. You're beautiful. I see so many beautiful people here. Like, everybody's beautiful. I'm like, oh, she's sexy, she's fun. That's what I want. I want you to walk down the aisle in the supermarket, and you walk and you say, whoa, there goes a box of prunes. The girl with the crazy glasses said, those are sexy. I'm gonna get these and put them in my cart, because if I eat them, I'm sexy. And the more I eat, the sexier my colon's gonna be. That's what I want. That's what I want you to remember. The other thing I want you to remember, you never say anything to yourself that you wouldn't say to your best friend. Because at the end of every day, you are your best friend. And that's gonna matter. So if you just close your eyes for a moment, we're gonna take a deep breath, and I'm gonna leave you with what I hope is a little gift, that if you ever hear this, or if you ever need me, and if you do need me, just go to @prunesaresexy. I answer questions, I call people back, prunesaresexy@hotmail.com. Prunes are sexy, Google it. I'll come up. You can always depend on me, and I mean that. There are thousands of people out there that ask me questions about whatever. I'm open. Even if you want to get coffee, remember the 11 pounds? So close your eyes, take a deep breath, and I'd like to leave you with this one wonderful gift, I hope. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. shine, let it shine. God bless. I love you all.